morning, everyone. Man, it's beautiful outside, isn't it? Nice. I was, I heard somewhere, or I read somewhere about this person that wanted to come from a small town, but he wanted to leave and go to the big city and be around famous and important people and connect with them. And he left for a long time, and then he come back home, and what he realized was that he did not have to leave that small town to find famous and important people. And, you know, and on that list, for some of you people that drink coffee, it might be the guy at the McDonald's drive-thru that everybody talks about how nice he is. It could be that English teacher that we all had. It could be that local cop, John L. Sullivan, that a lot of us had. Could be our local high school football coach that's very important to young people and famous. It could be our local minister who is very important and becomes been at that church for 35 years and is well known in town. It could be that Sunday school teacher that we all had. It could be that person that picks up our trash every week that we have that great connection with. Could be that little league coach that we had. Could be that local barber. Could be a firefighter. So he just realized that he'd come home, and it could be his grandma and grandpa. It could be his mom and dad. It could be his best friend. He'd come home and realize he was always surrounded by very famous and important people. And of course, we are very important to God, and I don't know if we'd say famous, but he does value us, and there is importance. But as this church, I think we're trying to make more of a connection where we go out into the community and become more involved and be that. And so we want to be the best version we can be of ourselves. We want to have good relationships with people and so forth. And there's a country song that said, "Everyone dies famous in a small town." But that could be famous for good things or famous for bad things. But we want to, encourage us to be the best version of ourselves that we can be out in the community and let God help us do that. I don't know whether there's anything real important announcements that need to be brought up right away, or are we good? August 1st, okay, which is just a couple weeks away, correct? Yeah. Okay. And I wasn't here last time. We're doing a different way of doing communion. We're coming up and grabbing it, coming forward. Okay.
And I don't care if this goes out over the air.
Okay. 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 Good. Yeah. Good. Okay. Anything else anyone wants to bring up? Oh, will you pray with me? Father, we're just so thankful to be important to you and to be of value to you. And may you use us to truly spread your message and to let people see you and to know you. And just as we go out in that community, let's keep mindful of all the people that touch our lives and the lives that we touch. And may we just be the best version of ourselves and do your will and not our will out in the community. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
You're the one who made the heavens. You're the one who shaped the earth. You're the one who formed my heart long before my birth. God's toward me are holy, full of love and grace. You are the one, you are holy. You are the one, you are worthy. You are the one, you are the one everlasting. Jesus, you're the one. You're the one who made the heavens. You're the one who shaped the earth. You're the one who formed my heart long before my birth. I believe you'll always lead. Days have been ordained. All your thoughts toward me are holy, full of love and grace. You are the one, you are holy. You are the one, you are worthy. You are the one, you are the one everlasting. You are the one I will worship. You are the one I will serve all my days. You are the one, you are the one everlasting. You are the one. Jesus, you're the one, yeah. You're the one. You're the one who shaped the earth. You're the one who formed my heart long before my birth. I believe you'll always lead me. All my days have been ordained. All your thoughts toward me are holy, full of love and grace. Serve all my days. You are the one. You are the one everlasting. You are the one. Jesus, you're the one, yeah.
Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you, Jim, for your introduction to Cafe Grace. And it's all about perspective. I think anyone that can see me can know I have not been here for 35 years. That's the hope. But maybe one day I will have been here 35 years. And also more for perspective, the scripture that I'm reading today from Amos chapter 7. This is something that really speaks more to me. And it's a good reminder for me about where I stand. The truth is, I'm a little bit uncomfortable every single Sunday morning when I bring the message. That's the honest truth. I take this work very, very seriously. You know, and so last week I was appreciative. I got a number of different compliments on the sermon, so we'll see where this one lands on y'all. I've been moving this past week, but anyways, again, this is a script that speaks strongly to me, coming from the book of Amos, Prophet Amos, chapter 7, verses 7 through 17. This is what he showed me. The Lord was bestanding a wall built with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, see, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass them by. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste. And I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent to King Jeroboam of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the very center of the house of Israel. The land is not able to bear all his words. For thus Amos has said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile away from his land. And Amaziah said to Amos, O seer, go flee to the land of Judah, earn your bread there, and prophesy there. But never again prophesy at Bethel, for it is the king's sanctuary, and it is a temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered Amaziah, I am no prophet, nor a prophet's son, but I am a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore trees. And the Lord took me from following the flock, and the Lord said to me, go, prophesy to my people Israel. Now therefore, hear the word of the Lord. You say, do not prophesy against Israel, and do not preach against the house of Isaac. Therefore, thus says the Lord, your wife shall become a prostitute in the city, and your sons and your daughters shall fall by the sword, and your land shall be parceled out by line. You yourself shall die in an unclean land, and Israel shall surely go into exile away from its land. Join me in a quick prayer. Heavenly Lord, we ask that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So the book of Amos, it includes a lot of imagery that speaks to some sort of impending destruction that God has already set himself to deliver to nations, and especially to the nation of Israel. Amos is also the book that gives us memory verse that has been made famous to us by Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Amos himself, he was a shepherd, and he heard the Lord speak to him, messages to proclaim on earth. Amos is a prophet. The words of Amos make it clear that God is passing a judgment on those that oppress and fail to care for the people beyond themselves. Our story today gives us three characters to reflect on. Of course, Amos, and then there's Amaziah, the other prophet, and King Jeroboam. Amos, we know again, is the Lord's prophet. Amaziah, he was a priest. He was a priest in the region of Bethel and a supporter of King Jeroboam and King Jeroboam's regime in Israel. Amaziah reports again to King Jeroboam. King Jeroboam, he was a king of the northern country for approximately 200 years. All of what we would sort of say is the nation of Israel was divided into two portions, with the northern portion with a northern king and a southern portion with a southern king. The northern king at this time of Amos was King Jeroboam. And so Amos is from Judah, the southern country. And Amos travels to the northern country to make and give and forecast the destruction that is coming against Israel. So Amaziah felt threatened by Amos's words, especially when Amos prophesied about destruction of Israel's high places and their sanctuaries. Amaziah responds to Amos's messages by trying to discredit the messenger. Amaziah misleads the king by claiming that Amos, not the Lord, has said these things. Amaziah also tactfully avoids any explanation at all as to why Amos had said what he did. Amaziah goes even further to accuses Amos of conspiring against the king. And then the priest himself goes on to order Amos to return to his homeland and receive pay for prophesying there, down in Judah. Amaziah, though, is the professional prophet. He is the one that is earning his bread from the hand of the northern king. Amaziah is doing what he can do through his actions and trying to protect his own self-interest and also the one that he serves. He's protecting the interests also of King Jeroboam. Because after all, he says, Bethel is a place of King Jeroboam's sanctuary. In verse 13, it is the king's sanctuary and it is a temple of the kingdom. And this is what is really striking. One would expect that a priest of the God that we know, priest of the God Yahweh, would expect someone to know that really he was in the Lord's sanctuary and in the Lord's temple. Amos responds to Amaziah with a, "You will not define me," sort of moment. Amos gives a self-biography and then really amplifies his message, the message of the Lord, and he just lays out these really harsh words for the people of Israel. Amos, again, will not allow Amaziah to establish the narrative where Amos himself appears to be something that he is not, nor will he permit God's message to become diluted. Amos makes his case that he's not a professional prophet. Professional prophets, they either charge or receive a fee for prophesying. And they are often trained to be prophets, and sometimes it's the family business. Instead, Amos earns a living tending to sheep and trimming sycamore trees. Amos is not prophesying for any sort of financial gain, nor does he have any training whatsoever. Amos explains he has brought God's message against Israel only because of God's commands. Such news would no doubt be frightening to Amaziah and King Jeroboam. We can be certain that in the time of the prophets, there were professional prophets that had often told the rulers the very soothing words that the authorities would have wanted to hear. Amos, he is solely in Israel, only to give an authentic word from God that is not comfortable. And this to me recalls a quote from the Bonhoeffer book that the elders are currently reading together. In Life Together, Dietrich Bonhoeffer writes, "To seek God, not happiness." We understand this is that we are not in church to be comfortable. We need to hear God's authentic words. And we know that God's words often do soothe us. That is one thing that they do at times. But there are other times that God's words, they cause us some degree of discomfort. God's words challenge us to transform the world around us, to live up with God's vision of the world. From today's scripture, we are given imagery of the prostitution of wives, murder of sons and daughters, stolen property, and a death that reveals you had no honor in your life. We are also given the imagery of a wall that has been built by God with a plumb line. God builds the wall. It is our job, our task, to keep it plumb, to keep that wall straight, to prevent that wall from collapsing in on itself. If we fail at our task to maintain what God has created, everything will come crashing down and be reduced to rubble. We are not exempt from the judgment. God empowers, encourages, inspires, and blesses us to uphold what God has provided. God has provided us with purpose to care for all of creation, for everything, and all that is life. So are we listening to the prophets? Or are we listening to the people that protect our own self-interest? Our scripture selection begins with what Amos sees. Amos sees God beside a wall with a plumb line. The idea is that Israel will collapse with God's judgment. The book of Amos uses the plumb line to measure Israel's situation in relation to God. Israel's behavior at the time was not appropriate. It was not an appropriate response to God's gracious love for the people. Israel was to love their neighbor and take special care of the widow and the orphan and on all those on whose behalf Amos was waging this prophetic campaign in the northern kingdom. But Israel lacked concern for those that would have been considered the least of these in the community. And therefore, Israel's high places shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries laid to waste. What does it mean to be faithful to a judging God, one that would lay our high holy places to waste and leave them desolate? It means that we are to love our neighbor, those that are oppressed and stigmatized, knowing that it is not us ourselves that are the ones that are being oppressed. We are the community of God. There are many ways in which we can be called to serve our community. How are we responding to local issues of mental health, substance abuse, inadequate housing? And how are we responding to the other issues, some that we see, some that we do not? How are we responding to these issues that prevent our community from being in line with what God has created us to be? Enough is not being done. Our community will fall if we do not work to get things right, right with what God has commanded. We are to be used to solve the problems of our society, knowing that we cannot do it alone. We can engage the full community and discern together with the help of God what it is we are called to do. It is important for us to point straight and true and plumb with God. When we orient our lives around ourselves and around our idols, we lack the right posture towards God. We are bent in on ourselves, and it is like building our homes on sand rather than on solid rock. And this disobedience is what leads to ruin. Faithfulness to God, on the other hand, means that we are in sync, paired up in harmony with the world's creator. Amos's prophecy comes against a king who has turned his back on the covenant to take care of those that cannot take care of themselves, those that need a little bit more help in society. And we learn, as we read through Amos, that the best people to share God's word, it's the lay people, like Amos. Not the prophets that are paid to be in their situation that they're in. It comes from the lay people like Amos. Ones that work in the fields. Ones that tend to animals. Ones that trim trees. God works through all sorts of people. Sometimes even those who we least expect. Ourselves. Bringing God's word to others is not easy. The opposition that Amos faces makes this abundantly clear. Despite the difficulties, the church is called to speak God's word for a world that is in need of direction. There are a great deal of complex issues that divide us. I don't have to share or get into all these, but I do because they're all right there in front of us. I understand we are not all in agreement about our southern border. I also understand that agreement that Americans are not all in agreement about climate change or health and safety of one another. But as faithful Christians, we have an obligation to pursue the path of personal sacrifice, following in Christ, so that those that are experiencing greater hardship than us can be lifted up. Last week, we were asked to learn from the prophets as Habakkuk challenged us to cast a vision and live by our faith. Amos, the prophet we're preaching from this week, gives us a similar message. Live by your faith. And the vision that he sets before us is a wall that will not fall because we all are working together, living together, to see that everyone is valued as being valuable.
Good morning. Most of you know that we've moved into a new house, and you always have hope in a new house that everything is perfect. However, all homes are built by people, and people are imperfect. So there are some things, you know, we've already found that are imperfect in our house. One of the things is Jim and I each have a doorway that we tried to hang a sign above or a picture above, and have found that doorway isn't quite square. The ceiling is, but the doorway isn't. So then you have the dilemma, do I line it up with the doorway? Do I line it up with the ceiling? Which way is going to make it look straight? And I think we do the same thing in our Christian walk. We have two lines. There's the earthly line, the way the world does things, and there's God's line. And as we try to line ourselves up with God, we're going to look a little off to the community. We're going to look a little off to those who are not believers. We have to be really careful that we're lining ourselves up with the right line. And we are grateful that Jesus lined himself up with the right line. Because on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this to remember me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup And he said, this is my blood. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for the forgiveness of sin. And in fact, I will not eat of this bread or drink of this cup again until I do so in the kingdom of God. Will you pray with me? Lord God, we're so grateful that Jesus did what was really unheard of in the world, to sacrifice his very life for others, to sacrifice his very life for those who did not know him, did not believe him, did not know truly who you are. Yet that sacrifice, which is beyond our understanding, is what is our saving grace today. And we are eternally grateful. In Jesus' name, amen. You're invited to come to the table and take your elements.
The invitation is here for you, for every one of you. It's your stories that preach. You each have an invitation to prophesy, to testify, to be a witness, to proclaim about how God has been active in your life and what you are called to do because of how the Holy Spirit moves you. And you're invited to share that story, your story, with all of us that are here. You're also invited to share that story with others out in the community, wherever you may go, as you live your lives and whoever you interact with. And hopefully, Cafe Grace, hopefully the idea is that this place here, you're safe enough, and it's warm enough and loving enough, where you can feel like it's okay for you to share your own personal testimony, your own story about how God is active in your life. If anyone wishes to ever share their story, you're invited to do so. It doesn't have to be right now today, but you can certainly do that. If you want to talk with myself or Brenda or one of our other worship planners or elders about your story, start there. and we'll give you time to speak in an environment where you can be heard. No judgment. Just you. And all of us to be witnesses to how God is active in you through your perspective. I think that's a great joy. And with that, let us sing a song together while we prepare ourselves. If you want to share your testimony, come forward afterwards and share it with us. But let us all stand and sing together to the everlasting God.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our God, you strong deliverer. As we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our God, you strong deliver.
Prayer. Lord, apart from our fragile lives, our world, Lord, apart from you, our fragile lives would crumble into ruins. Sustain us by your mighty power and help us rebuild our lives among those who have no home to call their home, their own, the poor of heart and pocket, the homeless, the hungry, the unattended, and the imprisoned. Amen. Join with me now in the benediction we've been sharing from Shane Claiborne. May the peace of the Lord Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again to our doors. Peace of Christ be with you. Amen.